Good morning, everyone. Lovely to see you today, and it's good for me to be back after a couple of Sundays off. You know, it's always a privilege that we should grasp and grab as much as possible to be in the company of God's people for worship on Sunday. So thank you for coming today, and thank you to all those who are joining with us online this morning. May God richly bless all of us today. Before we start proper, just let me make a few announcements. Please use all the precautions possible that you now know so well in leaving the building today. We're heading into Christmas week, so Christmas morning service next Friday will be at 10:30 a.m. through Zoom. I'm going to be speaking at that, and you'll receive a link to this service before Friday. Next Sunday morning, be a service here at 10:30 a.m. Don't forget to let Esther know if you're able to attend next Sunday, the 27th. Just an announcement for those who are involved in GCF West. There's going to be a meeting for all GCF West members and attenders at 6 p.m. on the first Sunday, the 3rd of January. So before we worship, just let me read a passage from Philippians 2, verses 5 to 11. Paul says here, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself, became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him to the highest place and given him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue should acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord. And so we remember at this very special time of year how Jesus enters into our world as a baby in a manger. As Charles Wesley wrote in the hymn, the incarnate deity, our God contracted to a span, incomprehensibility made man. Note that we read in that little passage there that Jesus left his sovereign position in heaven. It says in verse 6, he was in the very nature of God, who being in the very nature of God. Hebrews tells us this, the Son is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. And so the Son of God left heaven to live among humanity. It's a really amazing if you try to get your head around that. Jesus accepted a servant's place when he came. It says he took here in Philippians 2:7 that he took the nature and form of a servant. He condescended from the glory of heaven down to mankind. And then he also says in Hebrews 2, but do we not see Jesus, who was made lower than the angels for a time, who is now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death? And so he was 100% human, and yet we know that he was 100% God, human and divine. Jesus followed this birth through childhood, through teenage years into adulthood. It says that he led a selfless life, that he gave his life for others, humbled himself. Verse 8 says here, he humbled himself, becoming obedient even to death on the cross. And so we start at Christmas, but of course we're heading towards Easter, perhaps the most powerful of all Christian holidays. And so he prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane. As he begins to feel the cross coming upon him, he knows that he's going to bear the weight of the sin of the world. This is why Jesus came, isn't it? And he left his sovereign position, accepted a servant's place. He became truly human. He lived that selfless life, and finally he ascended to a supreme position. Jesus is no longer the baby in the manger. He isn't even any longer on the cross, he is the risen, ascended, glorified Savior. God has exalted him to the highest place. That's who we worship this morning, the risen, ascended, glorified Lord. Let's pray. Lord, this morning, as we come to worship you, as we come to hear your word, Lord, help us afresh to get a glimpse of who you really are. Yes, Lord, you are the baby who came to earth, incomprehensibility made man. God contracted to a span. Lord, we thank you for coming. Lord, we thank you for your arrival, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you lived a selfless life. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that you are now risen, ascended, glorified. And that is to who we come this morning, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, help us this morning, whether we're here in this building or whether we're at home today, Lord, to really enter in to worship this day and to consider you afresh. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to have our worship today. Both Jonathan and I are going to lead this.
To us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders. And he will be called a wonderful counselor, Mighty God, the everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Mighty God. And there shall be no end to the increase of his rule, to the increase of his government and peace. For he shall sit on David's throne, upholding righteousness. Our God shall accomplish this. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, the everlasting
of peace. Lord, you are the wonderful counselor. Lord, Lord, your name will be called Wonderful. Thank you, Lord, this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege of being able to gather with your people, Lord, to worship you on this special day. Thank you, Lord Jesus. by your mercy, Lord, that we come today. Praise your name, Jesus. You may take your seats. We're now going to have a children's clip. So thank you for running that.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to our Sunday school. Today, we are going to have a very special lesson about Christmas. So here we go.
Bible Animals Storybook by Dandy Daly McCall. Moory Christmas, the real story. Luke chapter 1, 26 to 38, and Luke chapter 2, 1 to 7. For a long time, everybody in the world have been waiting for Jesus to come, and now the time was finally here. God sent an angel to young Mary. Don't be afraid, he said. God has chosen you. You will have a baby. His name will be Jesus. He is God's only son. When Mary was almost ready to have her baby, she and Joseph had to go to Bethlehem. The city was so crowded, Joseph knocked on doors. We need a room, he cried, but every place was full. Finally, one innkeeper said, I have no rooms, but you can sleep with the animals in the stable. Mary and Joseph settled in with the cows and donkeys in the stable, and in that stable, baby Jesus was born. The cows mooed. Donkeys hee-hawed, sheep baaed, and Joseph and Mary and baby Jesus celebrated the very first Christmas. What it means to me. Don't you love Christmas? Presents, Christmas lights, Christmas food? Best of all, Christmas is Jesus' birthday. We wouldn't have anything to celebrate without Jesus. God loved us so much that He sent His only Son. Do you know why? So we could become friends with God forever. If we believe in Jesus, God forgives our sin, things we do wrong, and we become God's children. And when you become a child of God, God tells you, so do not be afraid, I am with you. Do not be terrified, I am your God. I will make you strong and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. We all have fears, and this is natural, especially in uncertain times as we are living today. But God assures us that when fear comes, the way to overcome it is having Jesus with us, because through Jesus, God is with us. This is what Christmas is all about. Jesus, the Emmanuel, is born, God with us. And because He is with us, we can overcome fear, for God promised us that He strengthens us and helps us, and the best part, He holds us in His right hand. Do you believe in Jesus? If the answer is yes, then you know what Christmas is all about. Now, that's something to celebrate every day and not just at Christmas. This is how God loved the world. He gave His one and only Son so that everyone who believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life. John 3:16. For I am the Lord your God, who takes hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. But now, this is what the Lord says, He who created you, Jacob, He who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. For I am the Lord, your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Since you are precious and honored in my sight, and because I love you, don't be afraid, for I am with you.
The 4th century Christian theologian, St. Augustine, summing up the birth of Christ, said this: The maker of man became man, that he, the ruler of the stars, might be nourished at the breast, that he, the bread, might be hungry, that he, the fountain, might thirst, that he, the light, might sleep, that he, the way, might be wearied by the journey, that he, the truth, might be accused by false witnesses, that he, the judge of the living and the dead, might be brought to trial by a corrupt judge, that he, justice itself, might be condemned, that he, discipline itself, might be scourged with whips, that he, the foundation, might be suspended from the cross, that he, courage personified, might be weakened, that he, security, might be wounded, that he, the very life itself, might die. Those are amazing thoughts and amazing words. And so Jesus has come into the world. We thank him for this today. We praise him. Now we're going to ask Peter if he'd come now and bring God's word to us today. Thank you, Peter.
Thank you, Stephen, and thank you, Jonathan, for leading us and singing those lovely songs that remind us of what Christmas is all about. Emmanuel, God with us. And as we're gathered together here in this church, and as you're gathered in your homes today, we know this. Emmanuel, God is with us. What a wonderful thought. Before I bring the message today, I want to read a very familiar passage from Scripture and share the Word of God. Through the prophet Isaiah, in Isaiah chapter 9, verses 1 to 7, we read, Nevertheless, that time of darkness and despair will not go on forever. The land of Zebulun and Naphtali will be humbled, but there will be a time in the future when Galilee of the Gentiles, which lies along the road that runs between the Jordan and the sea, will be filled with glory. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in the land of deep darkness, a light will shine. You will enlarge the nation of Israel, and its people will rejoice. They will rejoice before you, as people rejoice at the harvest and like warriors dividing the plunder. For you will break the yoke of their slavery and lift the heavy burden from their shoulders. You will break the oppressor's rod, just as you did when you destroyed the army of Midian. The boots of the warrior and the uniforms bloodstained by war will all be burned, and they will be fuel for the fire. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us, and the government will rest upon his shoulders, and he will be called. And think on these words, think on these names. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. His government and its peace will never end, and he will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. The passionate commitment of the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen. And that prophecy was fulfilled in part at the birth of Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. We're still waiting for the complete fulfillment, which will happen when Jesus Christ returns. I don't know if you've noticed, but there's been so much emphasis this year on light shining into the darkness. And the coronavirus has certainly brought quite an amount of darkness into our world. And if it hasn't been quite dark for you, it may certainly have been grayscale. But into the darkness, a light has shone. I want to say this. Christmas is not only an event that ushered in God's age of grace and hope for all of us. It is a holy event. It is a holy event. And in the words of Dave Mathis, God forbid that we ever get used to Christmas. Peter Marshall said, may we not spend Christmas or observe Christmas, but rather keep it. Let's hold it in awe in our hearts, not only in this at this time of year, but throughout the years. C.S. Lewis said this, the birth of Christ is the central event in the history of earth, the very thing the whole story has been about. And the story of the Christmas carol that I'm going to tell you about today does a wonderful job of telling this story. Throughout the Old Testament, we find messianic prophecies about the coming of our wonderful counselor, our mighty God, our everlasting Father, our Prince of Peace. Paul wrote in Galatians 4, verses 4 and 5, God sent him to buy freedom for us who were slaves to the law so that he could adopt us as his very own children. That speaks to us of the great desire God had for a relationship with us. And this is a reminder for us today. Those of us who are Christians, a reminder that God has brought us into relationship with himself. And for those who are not yet Christians, God is inviting you to come into that relationship with himself. Today, you and I, and all who have ever accepted Jesus Christ, and all who will accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, are the beneficiaries of what is known as the Abrahamic covenant. When God told Abraham to leave his country Ur and go to a place that he would show him, he promised that he would bless him and make him a great nation. But not only that, he promised that the whole world would be blessed through him. Would you agree that you and I, in spite of the coronavirus and all the things that have gone wrong this year, are blessed because of Emmanuel, God with us? Who would have thought that God's promised blessing of salvation would have come in such an unexpected and incredible way? God became one of us, but not a mighty warrior straight off. He came as a vulnerable child, born into this world just as you and I were born into this world. What an incredible story. What an amazing way to identify with us. God's ways are not our ways. Christmas reminds us of this. And his thoughts are not our thoughts. Would we have planned humanity's salvation in the way God did? God's ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. And we will see this very clearly reflected in the story that I'm about to tell you of one of my favorite Christmas carols. The story that I'm going to tell you today is based on a book that was written by Ace Collins called Stories Behind the Best Loved Songs of Christmas. This astonishing story of this particular Christmas carol began in France in the 19th century. And over time, it went global, or as we say today, it went viral. A French priest wanted a special poem written for Christmas, and so he approached a man by the name of Placide Capio. He was a wine merchant and a poet. The poem was not going to be the end of the story, and there are a few twists and turns to it before we come to the end of this well-known Christmas carol story. In 1847, when the priest asked Placide Capio to write the poem, it must have surprised Capio because, as someone said, he was more known for his poetry than his church attendance. But Placide agreed to the priest's request, and one day, traveling to Paris in a dusty coach down a bumpy road, as somebody put it, Capio used the Gospel of Luke as a guide, as a source for his poem. Reading the gospel, he imagined being present at Jesus' birth in Bethlehem. That inspired him, and it blessed him. By the time that he reached Paris, this poem that became a carol was finished. Now, I want to ask you this. You sitting here and you at home, can you imagine being present and witnessing the birth of Christ, coming to honor that Christ child as the angels did, as the shepherds did, as the wise men did on that very first Christmas day? And may I ask you this, and I ask myself, does imagining myself in that day, in that special place, in that holy place, inspire me? Does it motivate me? Thinking about this poem, when he arrived in Paris, Capio thought that it was more like an anthem than just a poem, and that it needed to be set to music. And he wasn't musically inclined, so he approached a famous musician friend of his by the name of Adolphe Charles Adams to write the music. Now, Adams was the son of a well-known classical musician and who had studied in the Paris Conservatory. However, the lyrics that his friend Capio had written must have challenged Adolphe, because Adolphe was a Jew and did not celebrate Christmas and did not believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. In spite of this, Adams wrote the score, and as they say, the rest is history. And the song was performed just 3 weeks later at a Christmas Eve midnight mass. This carol or cantique was well accepted by the church in France, but that is until they found out that Placide Capio had joined the socialist movement and that Adolphe was a Jew that didn't believe in Christmas. And suddenly they were no longer suitable candidates for this song, and it was banned. This just goes to illustrate for all of us afresh how God does according to his will. That his ways are not our ways. That his thoughts are not our thoughts. He accomplishes things as he wills. I'm reminded of how God used Cyrus as Israel was set free to go back to Jerusalem and Israel from their Babylonian captivity. When we puzzle to make sense of our lives at the moment, let us remember that God is not finished with us yet. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts are not our thoughts. God wasn't finished with this Christmas carol either. Its message needed to be proclaimed. Friends, you and I are living out the story of our lives. It's a reminder to us that God is not finished writing our story yet. And it's also a reminder to you and I that we too have a story to tell. A story of how Christ touched and changed our lives. Now, in spite of the ban of this song, the French people continued to sing it. And one day there was an American writer called John Sullivan Dwight who discovered this song. It touched him, and he decided that it needed to be brought back to his home country. He was a Christian, and he was a committed abolitionist. He published this particular song in his magazine, and it initially became very popular in America during the Civil War. There's another aspect to this song. There's a legend about this carol during the Franco-Prussian War. On Christmas Eve in 1871, there was fierce fighting between the armies of Germany and France. Until, that is, a French soldier suddenly jumped out of his muddy trench, astonishing his comrades and the soldiers of the enemy on the other side as he started to sing this particular Christmas carol. Excuse my French here, I'm going to try. Minuit chrétien, c'est l'heure solennelle où l'homme Dieu. That's the only clue I'm giving you as to what this Christmas carol is. Not to be outdone, the legend goes, a German infantryman jumped out of his trench and responded with the song, "From Heaven Above to Earth I Came," written by Martin Luther. And it is said that the fighting stopped for the next 24 hours. There was peace as both sides celebrated Christmas Eve. Peace in this world may seem fleeting and it may seem temporary. We may experience peace, but the peace that we experience tends to ebb and flow, doesn't it, according to our circumstances. But that's not going to be the case forever, because the prophecy in Isaiah 9:7 is still to be fulfilled. Speaking about Jesus, his government and its peace will never end. His rule will be fair and it will be just. And he will rule from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. And of his government and peace there will be no end. And we're assured that the passionate commitment of the Lord will make this happen. My prayer this morning is that wherever you find yourself, that you may know the God of hope filling you afresh with joy and peace. His joy and his peace as you and I affirm our trust in him today. Now the story of this amazing carol has still not ended. There was another man by the name of Reginald Fesselden. He was a 33-year-old university professor and former staff member of Thomas Edison. And I quote from the article I read. On Christmas Eve in 1906, Fesselden did something long thought impossible. Using a new type of generator, he spoke into a microphone, and for the first time in history, man's voice was broadcast. And over the airwaves came these words from Fesselden. And it came to pass that in those days there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. Interesting, isn't it, that the very first words spoken by Fesselden were from the Word of God. After finishing the reading of the scripture and speaking about the birth of Jesus, Fesselden picked up his violin and played this particular Christmas carol. And now, to add to its history, it became the first song that was ever sent through the airwaves via radio. When the carol ended, so did the broadcast. But the story of this Christmas carol has not ended. The Christmas carol continues to be broadcast around the world today through digital and electronic media. It is sung in churches around the world. Quite an amazing story, isn't it? Now, this Christmas carol is firmly rooted in the Word of God, and it contains some solid biblical teaching or solid theology. Pastor Tim Arndt, writing about this carol, said this: "Perhaps part of the power behind this song is that it does such a great job describing the character of Jesus and how his salvation impacts each and every one of us personally." As I read you the original literal translation from the French of this carol, listen carefully to the words and let their biblical truths impact our hearts afresh today. "Midnight, Christians, is the solemn hour when God as man descended unto us to erase the stain of original sin and to end the wrath of his Father. The entire world thrills with hope on this night that gives birth to a Savior. People kneel down, await your deliverance. Christmas, Christmas, here is the Redeemer. Christmas, Christmas, here is the Redeemer. May the ardent light of our faith guide us to the cradle of the infant, as in ancient times a brilliant star guided the Oriental kings there. The King of Kings was born in a humble manger. O mighty ones of today, proud of your greatness, it is to your pride that God preaches. Bow your heads before the Redeemer. Bow your heads before the Redeemer. The Redeemer has broken every bond. The earth is free and heaven is open. He sees a brother where there was only a slave. Love unites those whom iron has chained. Who will tell him of our gratitude? For all of us, he is born, he suffered, and died. People, stand up, sing of your deliverance. Christmas, Christmas, sing of the Redeemer. Christmas, Christmas, sing of the Redeemer." Doesn't this carol, the words of this carol, cause joy to arise within you? I trust it does. I trust that we have not become so familiar with the carols and the stories of Christmas that it no longer moves us. This carol causes us to stand in the awe and wonder of the Christmas story. It's a reminder to us of the holiness of our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It's a reminder to us of him coming into our world to redeem us, to make us his, to bring us to the wonderful joy of always being with him for all eternity and having that eternal life start now. Have you guessed what the Christmas carol is yet? Okay. I'll let you into it in a short while. God told a wayward Israel through the prophet Jeremiah, "I have loved you, my people, with an everlasting love, and with an unfailing love I have drawn you to myself." Those words are a reminder to all of us today why this first Christmas this carol speaks about came about. Jesus himself said these words in John 3:16, "For this is how God loved the world, that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." That offer of eternal life is yours to accept by faith today, if you haven't already done so. And if you're here or you're at home watching this and you want to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, this Christmas. Just close your eyes and briefly pray with me right now. Lord, I come to you on this Sunday morning and declare that I want your salvation. I want you, Jesus, to become part of my life. I come before you and I confess my sins to you and ask you to forgive me and make me your child. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. And if any of you have said that prayer, know that you are a child of God. Friends, think of the story of the journey of this song. It's a reminder to all of us that the joy and peace of the Christmas season has got nothing to do with our current circumstances, but everything to do with Jesus Christ and the way and the will of God in your life and mine. I want to quote from Friedrich Buchner. "It is impossible to conceive," he said, how different things would have turned out if that birth had not happened whenever, wherever, or however it did. For millions of people who have lived since, the birth of Jesus made possible not only a new way of understanding life, but a new way of living it. It is a truth that for 20 centuries there have been untold numbers of men and women, and may I add children, who in untold numbers of ways have been grasped by this Christ child who was born, and so caught up in the message that he taught and the life that he lived that they have found themselves profoundly changed by their relationship with him. Does that describe you and me? I trust it does if we're Christians. And if not, the invitation stands. If you said that prayer, then you can find your life profoundly changed by your relationship with him. I'm going to ask you to stand and just lift your hands as we play the Christmas carol that I've been talking about, sung by our very own Rachel Clark.
Oh, hear the angel voice. So led by light of a star sweetly gleaming, here came the wise men from Orient land. The king
for a while. O holy night, it reminds us that we stand on holy ground. I don't know how many of you guessed what the Christmas carol was. I heard quite a number saying Silent Night. Well, now you know. It's about the holy night on which Christ was born. I want to end this service by reading from Ephesians chapter 1 and verses 3 to 6. And say these words in your hearts as I read them to the Lord. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. Even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. And so we praise God for the glorious grace he has poured out on us who belong to his dear Son. It gave God great pleasure to call you and I. To make us his own. And so we praise God for his glorious grace that he has poured out on us who belong to his Son. Amen. and amen. The Lord bless you as you go into the rest of the week. And please do join us on Zoom if you would like to. And you're visiting today, we will give you, if you leave us your details, we will send you a link and you can join us on our Christmas Day service. As Stephen said, he will be bringing the message. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen and amen.